Welcome to Public Health On Call, a podcast from the Johns Hopkins Bloomberg School of Public Health. I'm Joshua Sharfstein, Vice Dean for Public Health Practice and Community Engagement and a former health commissioner here in Baltimore. Our goal is to bring evidence and experience to illuminate critical public health issues. If you have questions or ideas for us, please send an email to publichealthquestion@jhu.edu. That's publichealthquestion@jhu.edu for future podcast episodes. Today, it's a Friday Q&A episode. I speak with Dr. Crystal Watson, senior scholar at the Johns Hopkins Center for Health Security. We talk about COVID and even a little bit about monkeypox. Let's listen. Dr. Watson, it's great to have you back on the podcast. How are you doing?
Thanks. It's great to be here. Doing pretty well. Glad to be in the summertime.
Yeah, we're in the summertime, and it seems like for the moment that we're on the holding steady at a relatively low rate compared to the last couple years of COVID. How do you see things now?
Yeah, I think we're in a much better place, obviously, than we were last year, even going into last summer where we were seeing the emergence of the Delta variant. We are still dealing with Omicron and its sub-variants, and we're probably looking at somewhat of a surge in the coming weeks from the BA4 and BA5 sub-variants, but I think the consensus is that it's not going to be nearly as bad as the original Omicron surge. So I think we are looking at a much better place.
So what's the advice when people call you? I'm sure a lot of people call you and say, you know, what should I do? Should I toss my mask away? Should I, you know, run around and greet people with hugs? Or should I be much more, you know, careful? Because certainly these subvariants and variants are out there.
Yeah, I think it's really helpful to be guided by the data if we can. So looking at when there is a surge and there's a high number of cases and hospitalizations in particular, because that's a little more reliable in terms of the data right now. That's when I take more precautions, wearing my mask indoors, particularly if I'm going to be in a crowded area or someplace where I don't know people's status, whether they might be sick or unvaccinated. But I also think in large part, we're much more protected than we have been with previous surges. And so getting together with family and going to enjoy your life a little bit more is reasonable. But I think testing can also be really helpful in minimizing your risk of both bringing the virus to others. And if you've been in a situation where you're in a crowded place, indoor place, making sure afterwards that you're COVID-free and don't pass it on from there.
So this is what the new normal looks like, at least for now.
At least for now. I think it'll be this way for a little while.
So we've got some questions from our listeners. I know we used to do these Q&A episodes all the time at the beginning, but it's always good to catch up and we get some great questions. Are you ready?
I'm ready.
First question, why was smallpox eradicated, but COVID-19 apparently can't be?
This is a really interesting question. I like this question a lot. There are a number of factors that made smallpox eradicable and make SARS-CoV-2 not as possible to eradicate, not possible to eradicate, really. So first, smallpox only infected humans, whereas SARS-CoV-2 has many animal reservoirs. Which makes getting rid of the virus really difficult because even if we could stop transmission in humans, it could always spill over again from one of those animal reservoirs. The second area that makes it less eradicable or not eradicable, smallpox was actually pretty straightforward to identify, but SARS-CoV-2, COVID, is a lot harder. So smallpox, you have that kind of characteristic rash. And with COVID, you have basically flu-like symptoms, which makes it hard to distinguish from other things. So that makes it harder to stop. Smallpox was also transmitted primarily through respiratory droplets and close contact. So it's less transmissible than SARS-CoV-2, which can spread through both droplets and aerosols. And lastly, I think COVID right now obviously is really ubiquitous throughout the world. It's changing. The virus is changing very quickly, and it's causing reinfections. Even if you've had it once, you can get it again. So smallpox infection or vaccination both provided pretty long-lasting immunity and protection against the virus. And so, and in the case of infection, that could be lifelong in some cases. So herd immunity was much easier to reach with that virus than this one.
Sounds like SARS-CoV-2, the virus that causes COVID-19, is a craftier opponent than smallpox.
Much craftier and much more able to avoid our defenses, I think.
So next question. I've heard that long COVID may be less likely with Omicron. Is that true?
Yeah. So we're still getting data on this. Some studies are now being published. One study that was published earlier this month in June in The Lancet did show that there was somewhat lower odds of developing long COVID with Omicron versus Delta in particular. But we do need to keep in mind that this may change with new subvariants, and it still means a lot of long COVID in people, unfortunately, because Omicron is infecting so many more people than Delta did. So even though the odds may be slightly lower, and we're hoping to get more confirmation of that through studies, this is still a big issue.
How do you put together the risk of long COVID and how people should be responding to that?
Yeah, so I think we probably underestimate what long COVID might do to our lives. And so for me, on balance, it's still pretty important to prevent infection for myself and my family, both because less so now because of the severity of the acute infection, but now because we don't want that those long COVID syndromes that could really impact you for the rest of your life in some cases. And we don't really know exactly how that will manifest and how long it will last. So that is also influencing me to take more precautions, like wearing a mask still and testing before I go somewhere, testing after I leave. I think that it's a big factor for me.
Thanks. Here's a question. Is it okay to use expired COVID tests?
Yeah, so tests do expire, and when they do actually expire, they're going to be less likely to give you an accurate result. But the good thing is right now is if you can check with the manufacturer or the FDA website, a lot of these tests, their expiry date has been extended. They have looked at the tests and they work longer than they initially thought. So if you can go and check it out, you may have the tests longer than you think based on the expiration on the box.
Got it. And there are some sites that can help you figure that out, apparently.
Right. Yeah, I think if you go to the manufacturer's sites, that can be really helpful. And FDA, I believe, has some resources too.
Okay, here's a question. Am I more likely to get a more severe COVID case from someone who has never been vaccinated as compared to someone who is vaccinated and boosted?
That's a good question. So severity of COVID, I think, is probably related to a number of different things. But first and foremost, I think the susceptibility of a person who's infected to severe disease, given underlying conditions and other factors, and their immune system response. But in some cases, the amount of virus they're exposed to also can influence how sick a person gets. So generally, people aren't at much higher risk of severe illness from infection from an unvaccinated or an undervaccinated person, because the bigger factor is individual susceptibility. But it is true that in some cases, people who are not vaccinated can have a higher viral load and then potentially pass on more virus to the next person. So there may be some component of that, but that's not the predominant factor.
I think one of the more clear things is that people who are not vaccinated may be shedding virus for a longer period of time. And so the fact that they can pass anything on to someone else longer means it's better to be near someone who is vaccinated and boosted compared to someone who is unvaccinated.
Definitely.
So we hear these stories about people who are infected and then suddenly 2 weeks later they're sick again, potentially with another subvariant. This whole idea about waiting 90 days before getting tested again, do you think that will change?
Yeah, I think in some ways this has changed already because we have much greater availability of at-home antigen tests. People are using these tests to rule out COVID in many different situations. And right now the CDC recommends using tests if you have COVID-like symptoms. If you've had a known exposure, we're using them for screening at schools or work or going into a large gathering, and in some cases before and after travel. These tests are being used a lot more frequently than even if you've had COVID. PCR tests can still be much more sensitive and pick up virus for quite some time after a person is no longer infectious. So that recommendation with PCRs probably won't change. But I do think testing when you think you've had an exposure or you are having COVID-like symptoms with an antigen test is basically common practice now.
Got it. Even if you had it a month ago.
Yeah.
So we have these stories now of people who are sick, take Paxlovid, get better, and then get sick again afterwards, and sure enough, their test is still positive. Someone wrote in and said, well, then should I be treated again?
Yeah, so we know both from just reporting and anecdotes as well as the clinical trials that some people do have these persistent positive tests after they have been treated with Paxlovid. I think things to note are most people didn't have symptoms after, if they were still positive after treatment in the clinical trials. And there was not a high likelihood of people going on to become hospitalized and become severely ill. So right now there's not much evidence to support either a longer treatment course or a new treatment course if somebody is continuing to test positive after treatment with Paxlovid.
Great. Well, I want to ask you a bonus question on monkeypox, if that's okay.
Sure.
So we saw how many challenges there were in responding to a new type of infection when SARS-CoV-2 came onto the scene. Now we have another infection, which while it existed, you know, hadn't been this many cases, another infection that we're not prepared for. Yeah. How's the world doing?
I think we're racing to catch up with monkeypox, unfortunately. And this is a very different scenario than we've seen with this virus in the past. And so we're trying to ramp up our capacity for testing, our capacity for surveillance, our messaging to make people who are at risk aware of the symptoms and the risks that they face. So I think we're unfortunately behind the ball again. And with vaccine, although we do have two vaccines that are stockpiled in the US and some other parts of the world, that can be helpful for monkeypox. They are in limited supply, and so we're also racing to catch up on what do we do if we need more vaccine than we have in the world right now.
Seems like we still have some work to do to build out some of the basic capacity for response in this country.
Yeah, I think we have a lot of work to do to build up our testing capacity, our public health response capacity to new infectious diseases, and obviously our global cooperation and coordination, I think, is definitely in need of work even after COVID.
Even to the point of making sure that access to testing and treatment is equitable, it's a little bit of here we go again.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, monkeypox has existed for quite some time. There have been, it's endemic in some countries in Africa, and there have been epidemics, and we haven't taken it very seriously. So now that we have cases outside of the African continent, we need to make sure that that people in Africa also have access to the treatments and the vaccines and all the things that we're working on in the U.S. and other places for monkeypox.
Well, thank you very much, Dr. Watson. We really appreciate it. It seems like there may be no end to the Q&A episodes that we'll be doing on this podcast, but we really appreciate your spending time with us.
Thanks for having me on, Josh.
Public Health on Call is produced by Joshua Sharfstein, Lindsay Smith-Rogers, and Stephanie Desmond. Audio production by J.B. Arbogast, Holly Cardinal, Spencer Greer, and Matthew Martin, with support from Chip Hickey. Distribution by Nick Moran. Production support from Catherine Ricardo. Social media run by Grace Holes Fernandez and Amber Bryan Singletary. Thank you for listening.